Okay, so last time we have seen that by looking at the observation of GW1509-14, by comparing the observed signal just with the quadrupole formula, it has been possible to measure the chirp mass. Okay? Now, as I said, it is impossible using just this formula to find the individual values of the two masses, but from this it is already enough to learn a lot about the system, the binary system that produces the signal. Indeed, if we write this as a function of the total mass and of one of the two masses, okay, then this becomes m1 to the 3/5 times m2 to the 3/5, that is m minus m1 to the 3/5, okay, over m to the 1/5, okay? So this is a function of m1 and m2. If we plot this in the plane of capital M, this total mass, and m1, and we set this function equal to 28.6 solar masses, you find the function like this. Okay? This means that even though we don't know the total mass, m1 plus m2, we know that it is larger than a minimum. Minimum value, which is equal to 65.7 solar masses. So, just by measuring the chirp mass, we know that the total mass is larger or equal to this value, to this minimum mass. And this tells us something about the order of magnitude of the masses involved, but we can learn more. Indeed, from the signal, one sees that it's a chirp, no? So the frequency increases. So the frequency, in practice, if one plots the frequency as a function of time, okay, well, of course, there are several frequencies. So let's say the main frequency of the signal, roughly one finds something like that. So you will see plots like that, in which it's not really a line. There are a lot of points, but the brighter points are those corresponding to the leading part of the signal, okay? So the frequency increases in something like 0.2 seconds from 35 hertz to 150 hertz, roughly, okay? So before, for frequencies smaller than 35 Hz, the signal is too weak to be detected. And then after 35 Hz, it's just before the merger, then the frequency drops, okay? So this is a function of time in seconds, okay? This tells us that near the merger, just before the merger, the frequency of the gravitational waves is equal to a value, let's call it nu bar, equal 150 Hz. Okay? And of course, the orbital frequency at that time, just before the merger, is 75 Hz. Okay? The alpha. Now, then since the frequency is equal to this function of gm over L0 cube, this means that just before the merger, L0 is close to, say, L0 bar equal gm to one third over nu bar gw pi a two third. Is not equal, actually, even here, I would say, well, no, this is equal because it's measured. This is around because I'm using formulae that have been derived in the weak field limit, while here we are not in the weak field. So these are approximate formulae. They tell us that the orbital distance at that point, just before the merger, is of the order of this L0 bar, which we define in this way, okay? And this is a number that we know. Actually, we don't know because it depends on this m, okay? Now, if since m is larger than m min, which we know, maybe we can, yes. If m is larger than m min, then this means that L0 bar, the orbital distance just before the merger, is larger L0 bar min, which is equal to gm min at one third over nu bar gw pi at two third, which is equal to, if you put the numbers, 340 kilometers. Okay? So we know that the distance is larger than this. Now, if on the other hand, let's consider, just to have an order of magnitude what's happening, the Schwarzschild radius associated to a black hole with the mass equal to the total mass. Okay? Then this Schwarzschild radius is 2gm over c square. Okay? And we know that it is larger than Rs. 2g m min over c square. Now, if we compute the ratio between L0 bar, this orbital distance at the merger, and the corresponding Schwarzschild radii of the total mass just before the merger, this is gm to one third over nu bar gw pi at two third times c square over 2gm. And so it goes like m to the minus two third, okay? So we know that it is smaller than the same thing with the minimum mass here and there, okay? Which is just L0 bar min over Rs min. Now, this Rs min is, I didn't tell you, 194 kilometers, okay? So, this is a number that we know, which is 1.75. And so, we can conclude that L0 bar is smaller than 1.75 the Schwarzschild radius associated to the total mass. So we have learned, just with the quadruple formula, that just before the merger, the two bodies are very, very close, are at a distance less than the double of the Schwarzschild radii. And then this tells us something very important. The bodies are black holes. Because to the state of our present knowledge, there are no stars that can get so close. The most compact stars that we know are neutron stars, for which the L0 R is of the order 2.5 the corresponding Schwarzschild radius. So they cannot get at 1.5 close as a distance 1.5 the corresponding Schwarzschild radius, okay? So they have to be black holes. So we have learned just with the quadruple formula that these quantities are these bodies are black holes. And also we can learn something more. Let's consider the velocity of the bodies, okay? So just before the merger, the velocities are the separation, orbital separation just before the merger, times the frequency, orbital frequency just before the merger, which is larger than the minimum value that we know of the orbital separation times this that is measured. And if you put the number 75 Hz times 200 kilometers, you get something like almost 30,000 kilometers per second, which is 0.1c. So we have found something impressive. It is the first time that we have a macroscopic object moving at a relativistic velocity. Not only a macroscopic object, an astronomical object moving with relativistic velocity. Okay? So, summarizing, quadruple formula was enough for understanding the main features of this GW 150914. Of course, that was not enough to know more of this system, to really measure its parameters, M1, M2, and to understand the more details, the spin of this system. For this, we need to go beyond the quadruple formula. That I will do, but before doing that, so before showing, at least giving you an idea on how is it possible to go beyond the quadruple formula, let me briefly summarize the results of this more advanced modeling of the signal. So let me just tell you some information. So with this modeling, more advanced modeling of the signal, that is with the post-Newtonian expansion, but also with the numerical relativity and with the analysis of the oscillations of the final black holes, one has a model of the entire sigma, very good model, that has been compared with the observation of this gravitational wave signal, and it was found that the two masses of the two bodies are 35.6. I tell you there just to show you how precise it is. These are the two bodies of the binary, okay? After the merger, so these are the bodies of the binary. After the merger, there is a single black hole with mass, final mass, equal 633.1 plus 3.3 minus 3.0 solar masses, and dimensionless angular momentum, sometimes we call it just spin, dimensionless, so that is the angular momentum times C over Gm square, so divided by the G fin mass fin square, okay, the angular momentum divided by the the mass square and the normal with the proper constants. I call it is a dimensionless quantity. Is 0.69 plus 0.05 minus 0.04. Okay. Now some remarks about this. Yes. Also, I forgot, near the merger, the velocity is, I said before, larger than 0.1c. Actually, it gets of the order of 0.5c. That's really impressive, okay? We are speaking of bodies that are tens of solar masses, okay? Okay, some remarks. First remark, if you compute the total mass M1 plus M2, this is larger than the final mass. What happened to the difference? It is if you make the arithmetic 3.1 solar masses, the difference has been radiated by gravitational wave emission. Only by gravitational wave emission, because the black hole binaries are not associated to a significant, I not believe to be associated to a significant electromagnetic activity. So, and this is an impressive amount of energy, okay? So the energy emitted in gravitational wave is 3.1 solar masses times c square. So if you can do the computation, a solar mass is 2 times 10 to the 33 grams. C is 3 times to the 10 centimeter. And then you get 5.5 10 to the 54 erg, which is roughly 10 times the most energetic supernovae. Okay, so really an enormous amount of energy emitted in gravitational waves. Okay. Second remark. Well, as I said, no. Second remark. So this spin equal 0.69 actually is quite larger, because this final black hole is a Kerr black hole. At the beginning is a perturbed oscillating Kerr black hole. Then it is a simple Kerr black hole with this spin. And we know that the stationary black holes, that means Kerr black holes, have a bound. The spin has to be smaller than 1. Okay, so this is the order of the maximum allowed spin. But there is an explanation of this. This spin arises due to the conservation of angular momentum from the orbital angular momentum of the binary. That leads to this value. And indeed, most of the observed system like that have a final spin which is of the order of 0.7, because it comes from the orbital angular momentum of the binary. While the spins of the two bodies of the binary are much smaller, and indeed, well, we cannot say that they are zero, but they because there is an error in the measure, but the chi1, chi2 have values which are compatible with zero, okay? So either are zero or are very small. Third remark. The eccentricity of the orbit is zero. Well, let's say it's very, very close to zero. Let's say it is zero within the error. And this is expected by the theory, because if one models the spiral from much before than the part that has been observed, it can be seen that d over dt is always negative. So the eccentricity tend to decrease during the spiral, which is that is the orbit circularize. So the spiral we've seen it for few tens of seconds, but it takes much, much longer, okay? And in that period, the orbit become perfectly circular, which is what have been seen, okay? In the subsequent years, let me just complete this telling some general information before going back to the theory.
How was the eccentricity just before the measuring of the bodies or the binary?
Zero.
For both of them?
No, the eccentricity of the this is the eccentricity of the orbit. So the bodies are black holes, okay? So the only a black hole is characterized if it is stationary in itself. It's only characterized by the mass and the spin. The spin is very small, so they are roughly spherical black holes, okay? This is the eccentricity of the orbit. Oh, well, actually, the orbits are not the same because the radii are different, so it's not a single circle. Okay, in the subsequent years, LIGO and the Italian detector Virgo have observed several tens of such signals. So in the last observation period, this happened on a weekly basis, more or less. The joint analysis between LIGO and Virgo allowed, in some cases, to find the localization in the sky of the source by looking to the time delay between the detection by LIGO and that by Virgo. Okay, so it has been possible in some cases to find where the direction of the source with an error of the order of a few degrees. The masses of this observation range of the black holes observed in this way range from something of the order of 5 solar masses to something of the order of 100 solar masses. The spin of the final objects typically are the orders of 0.7, typically. But they have been observed, say in few cases they have different values. So it is believed that in the cases the original black holes may have significant spins from 0.14 to 0.83, just to give an idea. Okay, now let's consider. Probably you have seen many times the noise curve of the interferometer, just to understand. So in the noise curve, I don't have time to enter in detail on that, but one plots of the Fourier transform of the signal multiplied by the square root of the frequency as a function of the frequency in Hertz. And one is something like that. So you see there is a window. So here goes from something like 10 to something like 1,000 hertz. And roughly the idea is that if you have a signal which is above this curve, you see it. That's very rough because the things are much more complicated than that. There are sophisticated data analysis techniques, but let's give a rough idea. So the signal for the binary in the Fourier, so once Fourier transformed, has this sort of shape. So there is a small bump at the beginning, at the end, and then something like that. Okay, so this is a signal of a binary. It is a bit decreasing because of the tricks of the Fourier transform. Okay. Now, this is in the Fourier space, but since there is this chirp, the frequency increases, in practice, you can imagine this as moving that way, in the sense that at earlier time, most of the signals have low frequencies, and as during the chirp, the main frequency increases, okay? So you see the frequency increases up to a certain point, to the maximum value that is the one that I said before, then it drops, and it drops because there is the merger, okay? That's the idea. Now, I write this because what happens if you compare chirps with different masses, okay? So if you have a larger masses, if you have largest masses, then two things happen. The first is that H0, that I remember the amplitude goes like the chirp mass at 5/3, we've seen. So if the masses are larger, the amplitude increases. That's good, we have a louder signal. But the mass should not be too large, because there is another thing. The maximum value of the gravitational wave, which is corresponds to the so-called innermost circular orbit. Okay, so when the two bodies reach the innermost circular orbit, then there is the merger, and this innermost circular orbit frequency is something characteristic of the black holes. Now, since the only for dimensional consideration, since the only dimensional quantities that characterize the black hole are their masses, this frequency must go like 1 over the mass, okay? Then this decreases. For larger masses, this decreases. So, for instance, if let me repeat, make it a bit bigger. Okay. So, while for smaller masses, you have something like that. For larger masses, you have something up but that stops before, because the frequency at which there is the drop is smaller. And so if the mass is too large, it is true that it is louder, but it goes out of the sensitivity window. At a certain point, you cannot see the signal, or it is more difficult to see the signal. So you really, that's why one expects to see a part of which are the masses that are there, but you can see binaries in a certain range of masses, okay? The last thing that I want to say is just few words. I hope I will have time. Well, I'm sure I will have time to come back to that on different kind of signal. So this was the signal from binary black holes, but we have also seen binary neutron stars. So the first neutron star binary was GW170817, and as you can imagine from this name, it has been detected in 2017. And in that case, the masses are the typical masses of neutron stars, which are of the order of 1.4 solar masses. So one could think that one cannot see that because it is much weaker. But in that case, in the case of GW150914, I remember you that the distance is over the order of 500 megaparsec, okay? While in that case, since there are much more binary neutron stars than binary black holes, Then we have it is possible, we are the possibility of seeing closer, okay, just because of the statistics. So in the case, this was at 40 megaparsec. And so M over R was comparable. And that's why we have seen that signal with the same, these two very different situations with the same instrument. But instead of staying in the bandwidth for 0.2 seconds, the signal stayed in the bandwidth of the interferometer for something like 100 seconds, okay? I just want to say that the signal in the early spiral in the first part of this long signal is like that of black hole in spirals, okay? Because you can treat the bodies like point masses, so it is besides which is their masses and their spins, one don't care what they are. But then in the late spiral, then the so-called finite size effect become relevant, or become not really important, but become detectable. And so the signal is slightly different from that of black hole in spiral. And this is because the tidal interaction between the two bodies led to observable finite size effects in the waveform that I, hopefully, tomorrow I will say something about that. And another thing important to say about this GW170817 is that I said about the localization. Now, when it was that, while differently from black hole binaries, neutron star binaries were expected to be associated with electromagnetic emission. And then the LIGO and Virgo had agreements with all many telescopes of different kinds in the world. And as soon as this was detected, all these telescopes, and it was said that it is in that direction, then all these telescopes pointed in that direction. And they found a lot of so-called electromagnetic counterparts in several parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. In gamma rays, radio, optical, infrared, etc. Optical, infrared, etc. So this allowed to see not only the direction but also the distance, because it was understood in which galaxy it was, okay? So one had an independent measurement of the distance too. This procedure of comparing these different kind of signal is something that probably you have heard about, is the so-called multi-messenger astronomy. Okay? After that observation, at least another one of neutron star binaries has been observed, but in that case with no observed electromagnetic counterparts, and also at least two black hole neutron star binaries have been observed. Okay, but the only case of identified electromagnetic counterparts is that of that signal. Ok. So, since I'm changing subject, because now I want to say something about how to go beyond the quadruple formula, but then maybe it's a good moment to make just 10 minutes of stop, okay? So in my clock is 10 to 12, so let's meet at 12. So let's come back to the quadruple formula. First of all, let's analyze it a bit more closely. This tells us that the gravitational waves depend, at least mainly, on the quadruple moment or on the time derivatives of the quadruple moment, so on the changes of the quadruple moment. Let me write it in the reduced form, so in the traceless form, which is this capital Q. Where R square is xi, xi, obviously, okay? So in this case is, before it was R prime square, if, it depends on the variables. If x are the integration variables, is R square inside the source. And now, what does it mean that which is the meaning of the fact that it depends on the quadruple moment? Let's try to understand better this. To begin with, let us make an analogy. Let us consider electrodynamics. Now, if you have a system of charges, for simplicity, let's consider a discrete system, okay? Q R at, so R is the index of the charge, at positions X R, okay? Then this has electric dipole moment. And you know that this system of charge emits dipole radiation. Which depends, the main part of dipole radiation is associated to the changes in the dipole moment. And the field of the radiation depends on the first derivative on the electric dipole, the energy flux of the radiation depends on the second time derivative of the dipole moment, okay? Let me write in this way so that I have more space. Now, if let us now consider, so the radiation depends on the changes in the dipole moment. Let us now consider a system of, well, this is the leading contribution. There are also other terms that are associated to the time derivatives of the quadruple. The quadruple moment of the electric charges is QR, XIR, XJR. Okay, so with two X's. So in that case, if I write with an index, this is DI, XRI. Okay? So the, there are other also contributions to the radiation in terms of the time derivatives, higher time derivatives of the quadruple moments, or the octuple moments, and so on. Now, let us consider instead in gravity, for simplicity, Newtonian gravity, because the main results also holds in general relativity, a distribution of a system of masses, okay? A system of masses, MR, a positions XR, and again I can define the gravitational dipole moment. D G gravitational equal sum of masses time positions. Now one could ask, is there radiation associated to the time derivatives of that? Not really, because this dipole moment is necessarily constant. Indeed, D dot the time derivative of the gravitational dipole moment is VR, which is the total momentum, okay? And in an appropriate frame it is zero, but in any case the second time derivative is of course zero by conservation of the total momentum of an isolated system. So you cannot have dipolar radiation. So, and you can also, you cannot have monopolar radiation, because the monopole moment is just the sum of the masses, so the total mass, and of course by mass conservation m dot is zero. So what one has is instead that the radiation, as I showed in the past, in the previous lecture, showing in the previous lecture, is associated to the time derivative of the quadruple moment, okay? The mass quadruple moment . So, what happens is that in this multiple expansion that I will just now explain from what it arises, in the case of the electromagnetism, the first term appearing in the emission is the dipole contribution, while in the case of gravitational wave emission, the first term, so the leading term, appearing is the quadruple contribution, okay? But let us be a bit more precise. Let us answer to the question, multiple expansion come from? To understand this, let's go back to a point of a derivation that we have seen. So, let's assume a weak field. But relax the slow motion assumption. So V over C, we allow V over C to be small but not negligible. Of course, V over C cannot be close to one, as I will show, one cannot. So the point is, I want V over C to be small enough that it is possible to make an expansion in V over C order by order. So it is not negligible, so the higher order terms are not negligible, but it is not close to one, because otherwise one cannot make the expansion, okay? So I relax the slow motion approximation. So I remember that what is V? V are the typical velocity of the source, that I say that it is like the frequency or the order of the frequency of the typical motion of the source, which is also the frequency related to the frequency of the gravitational wave emission. In the case of binaries, it is the double, but the order of magnitude is that one, times the length scale of the source, which is what I called epsilon, you remember? Okay, but we have another approximation, that we are looking the wave far away from the source, and this is a very strong, very strongly satisfied, I mean, it is a satisfactory good extent. So, distant source, epsilon is much smaller than r, okay? And actually also lambda much smaller than r. So the only thing we are sure is that the source is very far away, and so we can totally neglect this ratio, and that we are in the weak field approximation. Now remember that, so I have the source, the origin of the source, then here there is the observer, and so this is the vector x, and of course I call r the modulus, Euclidean modulus of this vector, you remember? And you remember that I wrote HTTIJ equal 4g over c to the 4 p I, J, K, L, D3, X prime, T, I, J, retarded time, T minus X minus X prime over C, X prime, over X minus X prime, D3, X prime. You remember this expression, okay? X prime is the position inside the source, so you have that modulus of X prime is always smaller than epsilon, okay? And then the modulus of X prime is necessarily smaller than, or let me, okay, is necessarily smaller than the modulus of R. Now, so r much larger than epsilon, so modulus of x prime is much smaller than modulus of x, and then I can say that the 1 over x minus x prime is like 1 over r, because this is totally negligible with respect to this, okay? But as I anticipated, I didn't explain why, now I will. We cannot do the same in T I j of T minus x prime over C x prime. Because one could naively say, okay, I do the same. Here I say x prime is much smaller than x, and then here there is T minus r over C. But the point is that the source may oscillate very rapidly, okay? with time. To understand this point, let's make a Taylor expansion around x prime I equals 0, ok? Of x minus x prime. So x minus x prime is square root of sum I xi minus x prime I. Ok? Please stop me if you don't. I mean, it's a trivial computation, but stop me if there is a problem. So, the Taylor expansion is x minus x prime equal the function of when x prime is 0, which is r. And then, if I compute the derivative of x minus x prime, that is of this function, I get minus xi minus x prime I, but I'm computing at x prime equals 0, so I get minus xi over the square root of x over the square root, well, let me do it properly, equal minus xi minus x prime I over square root of xi minus x prime I square, which I compute at x prime I equals 0, and which is just minus x prime I over r, ok? So this is minus, sorry, xi over r. Xi over r, Taylor expansion, the derivatives times x prime. So here I have xi over r, and then I have x prime I over r, ok? Do you agree? And then there are other terms. So note that, so if I factor out r, this is 1 minus xi x prime I over r square. So this term is of order 1. This term is of order, x prime I is of order epsilon. Xi is of the same order of r. So this is of order epsilon over r. Okay? Which is, as I said, is very, very small. And then, of course, there is a term of order epsilon square over r square, etc. Now, one could ask, why? So this term is much smaller than this, because epsilon is much smaller than r. So why am I bothering on doing this expansion? The point, to understand this, so let me just write that this result, so that x minus x prime is equal to r minus xi x prime I over r. Ok? Consider in this expression of the stress energy tensor consider this Tij, T minus R over C plus Xi X prime I over RC plus etc. Ok? I can call Ni equal X I over R, ok, so I can just call this Ni X prime I over C, ok? Now, consider for a moment the Fourier transform of this, ok? So, the Fourier transform will be an integral over terms that go like e to the I omega t minus r over c plus, let me put n I x prime I over c, ok? consider this term in this, this omega are the typical oscillation frequencies of the source. Now here you have the first term, which is omega t minus r over c, which is much larger than 1 because omega r, okay, is goes like r over lambda, which is much larger than 1. So this part of the phase is a number much larger than 1. Then you have this other term, which is ni x prime I omega ni x prime I over c, that goes like, so ni are just sine and cosine, x prime I goes like epsilon, so goes like omega epsilon over c, okay? So it is 2 pi nu epsilon over c. Nu epsilon is the typical velocity, you remember? So is equal to 2 pi v over c. So this term, omega times this, if you are in the small velocity approximation, is much smaller than 1. But if you are in the comparable to a larger velocity, this can be of the order 1. Now, remember that, just to make a trivial example, if you have, I don't know, cosine of a plus small a, okay, if you have that a is much smaller than capital A, this is not enough to say that I can neglect the a, okay? Because if a is pi alpha, you cannot neglect a. You also need that a, and a is much smaller than 2 pi. Otherwise, you're not allowed to neglect the small a, okay? So for the same reason here, this is very large, but if this is of the order 2 pi, this cannot be neglected. While the other terms is much smaller than 2 pi, though I know that I can neglect it. And so all of, just to say that then I have to take this into account, okay? And then I have to take this into account, and then I can make a Taylor expansion, okay? So here I can write that HTT IJ equal 4 pi 4 G over C to the 4 projector TT projector IJKL 1 over R. I can put this outside the integral, okay? I'm allowed to do that. Volume d3x prime tkl function of t minus r over c plus x prime I n I over c comma x prime. Okay, let me write it with a vector notation. X prime scalar n is faster, okay? And then this is, I make an expansion, and this gives 4g over c to the 4 projector tensor 1 over r d3x prime. And then I make a Taylor expansion in time, okay? So I have first determine which this is 0, because I know that x prime times n over c goes like V over C, which is smaller than 1. Let's say that is not close to 1, okay? So let's do a Taylor expansion in this parameter. So imagine that it is 0,1, 0,2, even 0,0,1, but not 0,6, 0,7. Then there will be a problem, okay? Then this is TKL of T minus R over C X prime plus time derivative t dot kl of t minus r over c x prime times x per n over c, okay, plus 1 half t dot dot kl t minus r over c x prime x times n over c square, etc, etc. Okay? So I have an expansion. okay? Now, the first term in this expansion, I know it. The first term is in this expansion is, or the integral is, without writing all this part before, d3x prime, tij, which I know by the tensor virial theorem is 1 over 2 c square, d3x prime, t dot dot 0, 0, xi, xj, which is 1 over 2, q dot dot ij. We have seen this. This is the quadruple formula, this integral. Okay? Then there are other terms, okay? The second term is 1 over c, d3x prime, then I have t dot 1 over c comes from here, t dot ij, and then I have x prime k and k. Okay, I have this integral. And then I have another term, 1 over c square, 2, 1 over 2 c square, t dot dot ij, and then I have a xk n k xl x prime k n k x prime l n l. Okay? Note that this term is of the order of these terms times v. Okay? Because there is an extra term going, well, I can show you. I can show you that t dot ij x prime times n over c, well, n is of the order of 1, x prime is of the order of epsilon, t dot is like multiplying by the frequency of the typical motion, so it's like tij times nu epsilon over c, which is tij v over c. So it's like the previous integral, this one, times v over c. And again, the second one, t dot dot ij x prime n over c square goes like tij nu square epsilon square over c square goes like tij times v over c square. So you see that this is really an expansion in v over c, okay? But the terms in the expansion, what are? Well, are objects that have in the integrals a lot of xi, okay? So if v is much smaller than 1, only the first term is present, and we are in the slow motion approximation, and we have the quadruple formula. But if the other terms are present, then you have, so if v over c is not so small, then you have to include the other terms. And like the first term, I had to make some math using, I didn't do the proof, but if you want, I can show you. I mean, maybe after the lecture, it's a trivial computation using t mu nu semicolon nu equals zero, and the fact that the Gauss theorem and the fact that on the boundary there is no stress energy tensor. From this, you can get t 0 0 xi xj. You can imagine that from this you can something with t dot 0, 0 with xj, xi, xj, but here you have also xk, okay? And so on. Well, there are some mixing, but roughly speaking, this term can be written in terms of the higher order, higher time derivatives of higher order multiple moments, okay? So, in practice, one defines two sets of multiple moments, the mass multiple moments that exist also in Newtonian physics, and a new set that can be defined in Newtonian physics but are relevant only in general relativity, that are the current multiple moments. So the mass multiple moments are, well, first of all, there is the quadrupole moment, the quadrupole moment, which is Qij equal integral of, well, let me put 1 over c square, sorry, this is very dot jar, t00 of tx, and as I write before, you have xi xj minus delta ij third r square di 3x prime. Now I can write this in a slightly different way as follow. You know that when you have two indexes, if you put a round parenthesis, you are considering the symmetric part of the two indexes, no? Or when you have square parenthesis, you have the antisymmetric. Now you can also, there is this nice notation that if you put the angle parenthesis, it is this, okay? So it is the symmetrization without the trace, because this term is removing the trace. If you make the trace of this, you get r square minus r square, okay? So this is the so-called STF part, symmetric trace free, okay? So this is the symmetric trace-free part of xi xj, okay? And conventionally it is denoted with the angle parenthesis. This is useful because these are irreducible representation of the rotation group. So if you make a rotation, the trace part is not affected, while the other this part are mixed, the other components are mixed. Okay, now, then you define the octuple moment, qijk equal 1 over c square, t00 of tx, and then I do xi xj xk d3x, so you have 3x. So now you have, it is more complex, I don't write it explicitly, but the idea is that you have xi, xj, xk minus something times xi r square minus another number xj r square and minus another number sk, sorry, delta j, xi delta, you have something like xi, xj, xk minus a number delta ij xk minus a number delta I k x j minus a number delta j k x I, and the numbers are such that if you, whatever delta I j, delta j k, delta k I you put, you get zero, okay? So it means that it is this to which you have removed the trace part, okay? So this is the STF. And so on, okay? And then there are the current multiple moments there is the quadrupole it is defined S I J of T equal 1 over C T 0 I X J D 3 X. To which again we have removed the trace part, so you have I and J with the angle parentheses, and you have of course the octuple. This is an angle parenthesis, oh, zero. S I J K of T 1 over C T 0 I X J X K D 3 X and so on. So all means with more and more X's with the three indices there, okay? Note that in Newtonian physics only the mass multiple moments generate, only mass generate gravitational field. In GR, even if you don't have, if you have a mass, so all these things have to be differentiated with respect to time. So if something like that is constant, you don't have anything. If you have a constant mass distribution, so if you have a constant mass distribution but you have a current, the current itself, not just the mass density, but the fact that the mass moves, generates in general a gravitational field, okay? And so the current multiple moments are, this is a typical general relativistic effect, are belong to this expansion. So if one make all the so this is these are associated to the matter distribution, okay? So these are associated to the, let me write this, mass distribution, because in the weak field, in a slow motion approximation, rho is 1 over c squared t 0 0, you remember, while these are associated to the matter, so matter, to the matter, these are associated to the matter motion. Because, so the density of, this is the density of mass. Instead, the momentum density is like rho vi of some particles, goes like 1 over c t0i. So you can see this 1 over c squared t0 like mass density. This 1 over c t0i like a momentum, momentum density, or okay, and so or mass flux, if you want, okay. So these are multiple moments associated to the motion of matter, and with this definition, it can be with some math, it is possible to rewrite this expansion as follows. So finally, we get this formula that HTTIJ of TX equal to 2G over C to the 4 projector tensor in the TT gauge of theta phi 1 over R, because we are in the far zone, okay? And then you have Q dot dot KL, which is the second time derivative of the quadruple momentum. This is the quadruple formula. But then you have terms, you see, that contain, I don't know if I removed, but yes, I removed, but you had the integrals with the N You remember? Then depend only on the direction between the source and the observer. Do not depend on the structure of the source. So they remain there, okay? And so you have minus 2 n r s dot dot k l r, okay? So with the second time derivative of the octuple current, and then you have plus n r q dot 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 third time derivative of the octuple momenta k l r, everything computed at the retarded time. Sorry, I try to be a bit more. Plus n r q dot 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 k l r computed at t minus r over c. Ok? So the integral has been performed, you get the multiple momenta. So you see that you have terms of you have terms depending of higher time derivatives of the higher order mass multiple moments, and you have also terms with the current moments, and this is of order v over c with respect to this term. Okay, so see if in the slow motion case, or in general, since v over c is significantly smaller than 1, we can say that gravitational waves are mainly quadrupolar. Okay? Any question? Okay. Now, let me say something more. Please, if there is, if there's some doubt, stop me, even from remote. Yes.
The definition of the octuple moment.
Yes.
Not the integral is a factor c squared or c
is c squared, because if you consider it in Newtonian physics, it is just a rho xi xy xi xj xk. So it's q I j k equal. You have also Newtonian physics. Okay, which is then 1 over c square. So the 1 over c square is not due to the multiple expansion, but it's due to the fact that t0, 0 is the energy density, and you have to divide by c square to get in the Newtonian limit the mass density. So this is Newtonian. So this is this is only valid in the Newtonian regime. When, if you are in the GR regime, so the energy is not just the rest mass energy, then this is always valid. But tends to this in the Newtonian regime, okay? Other questions? And while in the other, there is 1 over c, because rho v is 1 over c t0i. Rho vi is 1 over c t0i. Okay, in the Newtonian regime. Clear? Okay. Now I want to say something different. Where was I? Let me go here. Oh, yes, I wanted to. So let's consider this formula, for instance. So I say that gravitational waves are mainly quadrupolar, but I can say this from a different point of view. So we can understand this because the main contribution is the quadrupole moment of the source. But there is also another reason related to this, but different, that under this statement that gravitational waves are mainly quadrupole. And I think it's useful to spend a bit of time on that. So this depends also on theta and phi, okay? This depends on R, this depends on theta and phi. Which is this dependence? Well, it is very hard to see here because this depends on each direction, one has a different projection. I mean, looking from this formula is quite complicated, but it is possible to write the dependence on, so if I have a source and I have far away a gravitational wave, if I'm wondering which is the dependence on theta and phi here, or the gravitational wave, the best way is to make an expansion in tensor harmonics. Well, to understand what I'm speaking of, let's first consider, for simplicity, let's open a parenthesis, consider a scalar field in flat in Minkowski. So, which is solution of the field equation with the source, let's call the source T. Okay? Now, far away from the source, the solution has this form. 1 over R times a function of T minus R over C is exactly the same proof that was done before, okay? Theta and phi. Okay. So, this is a function of the time, of the retarded time, and then of theta and phi. Now, if you want to understand the behavior of this psi over theta and phi, I can consider that any function of on the sphere, that is any function with the t equal constant, r equal constant, means that I'm considering a specific spheric surface, and at certain time, so any function on the sphere can be expanded in a complete basis of the function of the sphere, that is, you all know this function, are the any scalar function of the sphere can be expanded in the scalar spherical harmonics, that is, psi of tx equal, or I can write it here, I can write, this is 1 over r, sum from L from 0 to infinity, sum from M from 0 to L, from minus L to L, of some coefficients that now depend only on T, Lm, Y Lm of theta and phi. Okay? You all know this. Now, these coefficients that depend on the indices Lm and on that on time can be found if we know this function using the orthogonality property, because since YLM Y star L prime M prime of theta phi integrated is equal to delta, so then I can get that psi Lm of T is equal to the integral of R phi of Tx times y star Lm of theta phi. That's very easy. Now, in this expansion, the index L corresponds, each value of the index L corresponds to a different representation of the rotation group, because for instance, when L equals 0, you have just one value of M. When L equals 1, you have 3, 1 M. You have 3 M's. When L equal 2, you have 5 values of m's from minus 2 to 2. Now, when you make a rotation, the 3 components and L equal 1 mixes among them, the 5 components mixes among them, and so on, okay? So this is the monopole, this is the dipole, and this is the quadrupole contribution, this expansion, and then there is the octuple, and so on, okay? So L equal 1, M equal minus 1, 0, 1 are the 3 components of the dipole part of this field, and so on, okay? Just a word, this can also be understood in Cartesian coordinates, so it's just a different way to see the same thing. I just introduced this symmetric trace-free notation. So I can also write in general that these 3 components, I can write this equal some constants, say 1 mi times ni, where ni, remember that are sin theta cos phi, sin theta sin phi cos theta. You remember that the spherical harmonics with L equal 1 are, have a cosine theta and a sine theta, no? So they are just, if you put the combination of these 3, you get exactly these 3. While y00, well, is a constant, and the y2m at the same time, in the same way, is c, some constant that I will call c2m ij, and then ni, nj minus 1 third delta ij, which is c2m ij, ni, nj. So this, if you write this, how many are these components? It's a matrix 3 times 3, symmetric, traceless, so there are 5 components. So these 5 components are combination of these 5 harmonics, and so on. So this is just a way to write this this harmonics. Anyway, if you have a transfer, for this reason, the quadrupole corresponds to the 2 indexes STF, the octuple to 3 indexes, and so on. Okay. Now, if this is if you have a scalar, what if you have a vector on a sphere? If you have a vector on the sphere, so for r and t constant, imagine that it is also a transverse vector, so n I v I is 0. Which is then this vector field on the sphere can be expanded in a complete basis. So this tells us that it was a complete basis, okay? And you have again a complete basis of all vectors on the sphere that are the vector spherical harmonics. Let's say, actually there are 2 kinds of this, the basis is composed of 2 parts. There are the V plus, let's say, I L, Lm of theta phi, and V minus I Lm of theta phi. So, for instance, V plus Lm I, of course, there are 3 components, because you have V plus Lm 1, V plus Lm 2, V plus Lm 3, and so on, okay? So you have a vector, so 3 components, with a Euclidean vector, with I equal 1, 2, and 3, but there are the indices Lm, like in this case you had these scalars, the scalar spherical harmonics, then you have the vector spherical harmonics, okay? And y plus and minus, where they are 2 families, because that the transform in a different way under parity. So any function vector, which is a also a function on the sphere, is a combination with constant coefficients of all these with different L's and M, that in general will contain a part depending on the V plus and the part which is a combination of the V minus. Okay? Now, so these are a complete basis because there are orthogonal an orthogonality relation like that one. Okay? On the transverse vectors on the sphere. And similarly, now if you have let me remove here. If you have a tensor field on the sphere, that where I wanted to arrive, I wanted to consider this, which is the, where for tensor I mean a tensor on the Euclidean space. So a rank 2 symmetric. So before I said transverse vector, now I say rank 2 symmetric trace free tensors on the sphere, which is means function of just theta and phi, okay, can be expanded in the complete basis of tensor spherical harmonics. Again, there are two kinds. There are the plus, so those that are even for parity, and there are the minus that are odd for parity. So they have two indices. So these are 3 times 3, each of them, for each value of L and M, you have a 3 times 3 matrix of functions of theta and phi. How are they done? Well, it's not important for what I want to tell you. It's just that, like the spherical harmonics, these are well-known functions. Okay, actually, they can be built in terms of the spherical harmonics with the same L and M. Okay, so for instance, I can tell you T plus Lm, just to have an idea of ij, is proportional to the projector ijkl. D square dk dl ylm with the same L and M, just to say. So you see that these are just functions on the sphere, but the point is that again, those with a given, so for instance, when L equal 2, you have the function with L equal 2, and there are 5, because M goes from minus 2 and 2. So you have a 5, well, this 5 and this 5, and each of them, this 5 transform among them for a rotation, this 5 transform among them for a rotation. So for each L, you have an irreducible representation of the rotation group. Okay? Now, all this to say that it can be shown that, sorry, I go on this side, the solution of the gravitational, well, let me rewrite it from a strict screen. Well, I didn't want it. The solution of the gravitational wave equation far away from the source without only assumption so with the only assumption that is what I said, R much larger than epsilon, nothing more. Okay, far away, no other assumption. So on the source there may be strong field and large velocities. We don't care because now I'm looking on the shape of the solution far away. And far away I know that I am in the weak field limit, okay? And it has this form. Sorry, give me another 5 minutes and I'm finished. This tells us a lot about gravitational waves. Sorry? Yes, but no, because no, this coefficient is just an expansion of this. So then I'll tell you about the relation of retarded time in 3 minutes. But for the moment, this just forget about how they were generated. They have this form, okay? So they are combination of this function of theta phi, which are tensor spherical harmonics with these coefficients, okay? And remarkably, look this, L starts from 2, okay? So this tells you that you don't have L equal 0, you don't have L equal 1. Actually, in the electromagnetism, also you don't have L equal 0, you don't have monopole radiation, okay? When one say that there are spherical waves, one mean that they are uncorrelated superposition, but a specific wave cannot be spherical because it cannot be monopolar. Starts from dipole. Instead, gravitational wave starts from quadrupole, okay? These functions, these coefficients, can be obtained using the orthogonality relations of the tensor spherical harmonics, if you know the way everywhere, but they depend on the source. The coefficient that tell how much of quadrupole, how much octuple is present, depends on, of course, the source. And nicely, so no L equal 0, no L equal 1. So no monopole radiation, no dipole radiation, okay? And a nice thing is that the coefficient, let me put in this way so you, the coefficients with the given, I put it here. I put it downstairs. The coefficients with a given L are obtained from the multiple moments with the same L. So with the same, so it can be shown that A plus Lm equal a constant times the coefficient that I said changing the basis Lm from the STF basis, which is just a number. Then there is the lth time derivative of the mass multiple moment QE1IL, okay? While the one with the minus are equal to const times the coefficient, the same thing, but with the current multiple moment. So the dipole radiation is obtained from the second time derivative of the, even in this expansion, you see that when you call the dipole radiation, it's not, when you say the quadrupole radiation, it's not only because it is sourced by the quadrupole, but because it has a quadrupole shape globally, okay? Because the quadrupole part of the radiation is generated by the second time derivative of the quadrupole moment. The octuple part on the third time derivative of the octuple moment, and so on. While this is the part even for parity. The part odd with parity are generated by the current multiple moments, okay? So you see that the expansion, the quadruple expansion that I've been showing before of the source, each term is suppressed by a factor v over c with respect to the previous one, correspond to the multiple expansion of the wavefront, far away from the source. Okay? So the quadruple moment generates a quadruple wave and so on. Any question? Also from remote? Oh, there are no, there's nothing from remote. Please, in remote, if you have any question, speak up or write. And okay, so unfortunately, the tutor Andrea Maselli had a problem, couldn't come today. Maybe tomorrow, but I don't think it's likely, but let's see. So today there will be no exercise session. There will be at 4:30 the office hour, so you can come to me, and especially for the remote, but also for you, and I will be happy to answer and to discuss on everything for 4:30 to 5:30. Okay? Goodbye.